Welcome to Developing Graphics Frameworks with Python and OpenGL, Part 1, Core Concepts and Vocabulary. Before we start with the programming end, we're going to need to learn about some basic vocabulary that we will be using throughout this video series. So to begin, our primary goal is to generate two-dimensional images of three-dimensional scenes. And this process is called rendering the scene. Scenes may contain two- and three-dimensional objects, from simple geometric shapes, such as boxes or spheres, to complex models representing real-world or imaginary objects, such as teapots or alien life forms. These objects may appear to be a single color, or their appearance may be affected by textures, that is, images applied to the surfaces, or light sources that result in shading and shadows, or even environmental properties such as fog. Scenes are rendered from the point of view of a virtual camera, whose relative position and orientation in the scene, together with properties like its angle of view and depth of field, will determine which objects are visible or partially obscured by other objects when the scene is rendered. Here on this slide, you'll see a 3D scene containing multiple shaded objects and a virtual camera at the lower right. The region within the truncated pyramid shape outlined in white is the visible region of the camera, called a frustum. And in this figure, the region completely contains the red and green cubes. It contains part of this blue sphere, but this yellow cylinder lies completely outside the region, which is visible to the camera. And the results of rendering the 3D scene are shown over here to the right. From a more technical, lower-level perspective, rendering a scene produces a raster, an array of pixels or picture elements, which will be displayed on a screen, arranged in a two-dimensional grid. Pixels are typically extremely small, but zooming in on an image can illustrate the presence of individual pixels. For example, in the previously rendered scene, zooming in on this rectangular region, you can see the individual pixels as squares of color. On modern computer systems, pixels specify colors using triples of floating point numbers between 0 and 1 to represent the amount of red, green, and blue light present in a color. A value of 0 represents no amount of that color is present, while a value of 1 represents that color as being displayed at full intensity. These three colors are used, red, green, and blue, because photoreceptors in the human eye take in those particular colors. The triple 0100 represents the color red. The triple 010 represents the color green. And the color 001 represents the color blue. If all components are set to 0, no light is emitted, resulting in the color black, while if each value is 1, then white light is the result. And in this chart, you can see a number of different colors and their corresponding RGB values. Now, the quality of an image depends on its resolution, which is the number of pixels in the raster, and its precision, the number of bits used for each pixel. Each bit has two possible values, 0 or 1. So the number of colors that can be expressed with n-bit precision is 2 to the n. So for example, our early video game consoles with 8-bit graphics were able to display 2 to the 8, or 256, different colors. A monochrome, or a black and white display, could be said to have 1-bit graphics, while modern displays often feature high color, or true color graphics. The figures here illustrate images rendered with different resolutions and precisions. So, for example, the sequence of four images of the two cubes. As the resolution is lowered, it appears more pixelated. Meanwhile, on the right, you have a color image rendered with different bits of color. So for example, this top left image is rendered using 3-bit color, which means you can get 2 to the 3 or 8 different colors. And sure enough, the colors you see here are white and black, red, green, blue, cyan, yellow, and magenta. You get 8 colors. To the right, here is a 5-bit color image, and then a 7-bit color image, and then the image in full color. Now, in computer science, buffers are going to be very important, especially in computer graphics. A buffer is a part of computer memory that serves as temporary storage for data while it's being moved from one location to another. Pixel data is stored in a region of memory called the frame buffer. A frame buffer may contain multiple buffers that store different types of data for each pixel. At a minimum, the frame buffer must contain a color buffer, which stores red, green, blue values. When rendering a 3D scene, the frame buffer must also contain a depth buffer, which stores distances from points on scene objects to the virtual camera. Depth values are used to determine whether the various points on each object are in front of or behind other objects from the perspective of the camera, and whether they're visible when the scene is rendered. If one object obscures another object and transparency is desired, the renderer might also use alpha values, floating point numbers between 0 and 1, that specifies how overlapping object colors should be blended together. The value 0 indicates transparency, while the value 1 indicates opacity, a fully opaque color. And alpha values can be stored in the color buffer along with RGB color values, and that combined data is often called RGBA color values. And finally, frame buffers can contain a buffer called a stencil buffer, which is typically used for advanced effects, such as shadows or reflections or rendering a portal style effect. Now, in addition to rendering three-dimensional scenes, another goal in computer graphics is to create animated scenes. An animation consists of a sequence of images displayed in quick enough succession that the viewer interprets the objects in the images to be continuously moving or changing in appearance. Each image that is displayed is called a frame. The speed at which these images appear is called the frame rate and is measured in frames per second. The standard frame rate for movies and television is 24 frames per second. Computer monitors typically display graphics at 60 frames per second. But for something like virtual reality simulations, developers aim for 90 frames per second as a minimum, because lower frame rates might actually cause disorientation and other negative side effects in users. And since computer graphics must render these images in real time, often in response to user interaction, it's vital that computers can do so quickly. In the early 1990s, computers relied on the central processing unit circuitry to perform the calculations needed for graphics. As real-time 3D graphics became increasingly common in video game platforms, such as arcades or gaming consoles or personal computers, there was increased demand for specialized hardware to render these graphics. And this led to the development of the graphics processing unit, or GPU. The term was coined by the Sony Corporation, referring to the circuitry in their PlayStation video game console released in 1994. The Sony GPU performed some graphics-related computation, including managing the frame buffer, drawing polygons with textures or images that are applied, and some shading and transparency effects. The term GPU was popularized by the NVIDIA Corporation in 1999 with their release of the GeForce 256, a single-chip processor that also performed geometric transformations and lighting calculations, in addition to these other rendering computations performed by the Sony GPU. NVIDIA was also the first company to produce a GPU capable of being programmed by developers. Every geometric vertex could be performed geometric computations on it, and every rendered pixel could also be calculated upon as well. The next processor, the GeForce 3, was introduced in 2001 and was also used in the Xbox video game console. In general, GPUs, they use a highly parallel structure, which we'll talk about later when we talk about the graphics pipeline, that enables them to be much more efficient than CPUs for rendering computer graphics. And as computer technology advances, so does the quality of the graphics that can be rendered. As you may have noticed, modern systems can actually produce real-time photorealistic graphics at high resolutions. Now, programs that are run by the GPU are called shaders. And they're called shaders because originally they were used for shading effects, but now they perform many different computations required in the rendering process. And just as there are many high-level programming languages, such as Java or JavaScript or Python, that are used to develop CPU-based applications, there are many shader programming languages. Every shader language implements an API, an application programming interface, which defines a set of commands and functions and protocols that can be used to interact with an external system. In this case, the API interacts with a GPU. Some of the APIs and their corresponding shader languages include the DirectX API and high-level shading language, also known as HLSL. And that's used on Microsoft platforms, including the Xbox console. There's the Metal API and the Metal shading language, which is used on modern Mac computers, iPhones, and iPads. And there's also the OpenGL, or Open Graphics Library API, and its corresponding OpenGL shading language called GLSL. And that's a cross-platform library that runs on many different operating systems. In this video series, we're going to focus on OpenGL. It's the most widely adopted graphics API. It's a cross-platform library, so visual results will be consistent on any supported operating system. It can be used in a concert with many high-level languages using something called bindings. Those are software libraries that bridge two different programming languages. For example, to program a graphics application with Java, you might use JOGL. If you wanted to program a graphics application using JavaScript, you might also use WebGL. Here, we're going to be using Python, and so we'll use a library called PyOpenGL. And OpenGL was initially released in 1992, so it's been around for a while. And it's been managed by the Kronos Group since 2006. And the Kronos Group is a non-profit technology consortium, and the members include graphics card manufacturers and technology companies. And the OpenGL specification is regularly updated to support new features and functions, many of which we're going to learn about in this video series. The next topic we're going to learn about, again before we get into the programming, is something called the graphics pipeline, which explains the different stages that happen when you are rendering 3D graphics.